Hello everyone, my name is Keiji Yoshida. Today I'd like to talk about tips for creating a good package in Go. First of all, I'd like to introduce myself. I've been working as a software engineer for 8 years. Now, I work for Recruit Communications Company Limited in Tokyo, Japan. I've created and I'm currently maintaining several web applications. I use Java and Ruby at work, and I use Go exclusively for my private work. I started using Go at the beginning of last year. I became a contributor to Martini, which is a web application framework for Go. Later, I gave a presentation about that framework at a Go conference in Tokyo. And I created several packages in Go. For example, I created an HTML template engine for Go, like Haml, and a pure Go CSS preprocessor, such as Sass. And recently, I created an MQTT client in Go. The goal of this presentation is to share my knowledge of creating a successful Go package. Up until now, I've created and deployed several packages, and I've learned some good tips for creating a Go package through trial and error. So today, I'd like to share these tips with you. Therefore, this presentation is for beginners of Go who want to create their own Go package. So let's move on to the main subject of the presentation. The first tip I'd like to share is about following the standard Go coding style. We should follow the standard Go coding style as written in the articles of effective Go and code review comments. There are a lot of rules, such as every exported name in a program should have a dot comment. There are many rules, and it's difficult to memorize and follow all of them during coding. We can solve this issue by using GoLint. GoLint is a linter for Go source code. It checks to see if the source code is following the standard Go coding style or not. When it finds style mistakes, it prints them out as shown on the slide here. And Go import is not a good tool for formatting Go source code. It formats Go source code just as GoFont does. In addition, it organizes import lines in groups with blank lines between them, like this example code. Next, I'd like to talk about how to make Go packages extensible. In Go, we can export an identifier like a type and a function by capitalizing its first letter. However, we shouldn't export all identifiers because exported identifiers are difficult to modify. The modification to an exported identifier will affect all of the other packages programs which use it. So we should export only identifiers when necessary. In the example code, the private struct type is exported, but it shouldn't because it's supposed to be used only the same package. So we should make its first letter lowercase like in the lower example. Using option struct as a parameter is not a standard way, but it's a good way to make a Go package more extensible. Suppose we define a dog struct and its construct function. In this example code, the dog struct has a name field, and the new dog function takes a name string as a parameter, creates a dog instance, and returns it. In the main function, the new dog function is called to create a dog instance. And then, suppose we need to add an age field to the dog struct. We want to add an age parameter to the new dog function to initialize the dog instance, but actually we cannot because the new dog function has already been exported, and if we change its signature, all of the other packages programs that use that call this function will need to be modified. So all we can do is create a setEdge method which takes an edge parameter and set it to the dog instance. In the main function, we need to call two functions, newDog and setEdge, to initialize the dog instance. If the same thing happens over and over again, this package becomes enlarged, and the clients of the package have to call many functions, such as newDog, setEdge, setSpecies, and so on, to initialize the dog's instance. We can avoid this situation by using option struct as a function parameter. In this example code, I define the option struct, which has a name field, and the newDog function takes the option struct as a function parameter instead of the name string. And if you need to add an age field to the dog struct, we can complete our task without modifying the signatures of the existing functions and creating a new method. All we have to do is add an age field to the dog and option struct and modify the new dog function to initialize the age field of the dog instance. We don't need to modify the signature of the new dog function or add a set age method. This code is flexible to the future addition of dog's field. Like this, using option struct makes a Go package more extensible. Dividing a larger struct into smaller ones is another good way to make a Go package simple and easy to extend. When I started creating an HTML template engine, I created a single struct named element, which represented all of the template file's elements, such as an HTML tag and an include operation, as this figure shows. This struct became very large because it contained processing for all element types and lost its maintainability. In this example code, the element struct write-to method has a switch block which contained all element types processing, and that made this package large and complex. To make this package simple and extensible, I divided the element struct into smaller ones, such as an HTML tag struct and an include struct, as this figure shows, and I created an element interface and made each struct implement this interface. Here is the example code. I defined the element interface in which the IO writer to interface was embedded, and I defined the HTML tag and include struct and made them implement the write to method so that they implemented the element interface. By having done this, I could divide a single large processing into smaller ones, and that made my package more maintainable and extensible. In addition, each element had its child elements just like each HTML tag did. In this example code, both HTML tag and include struct had the same children field, which was a slice of the elements. And they also had the same append method, which took an element as a parameter and appended it to their children field. So the children field and append method were defined redundantly. That was inefficient and made the package complex. So I decided to get rid of this redundancy by embedding a struct. I created an element-based struct which had fields and methods common among elements. And I embedded the element-based struct into the struct which implemented the element interface. Here is the example code. I defined the element-based struct which had the children field and append method. And this element-based struct was embedded into the HTML tag and include struct. By having done this, I could get rid of the duplicate fields and methods. Like this example, creating and embedding a common struct is a good way to make a Go package more maintainable and extensible. Next, I'd like to talk about how to give users the freedom of using our package. Flexibility is important for Go packages because the more flexible they are, the easier they are to use. One of the ways to give users freedom is to give users the option to call API sequentially or concurrently. When I released my CSS pre-processing package, which compiled a simplified custom CSS format file into a pure CSS format file like SAS did, I made the compile function always run concurrently, because it involved many I/O blocking processing, such as reading files and writing data to files. Here is the example code. In the compile function, another Go routine is launched, and the channel named chpath is written quickly. In the Go routine, the simplified custom CSS format file is read and compiled into a pure CSS format file, and its path is sent to the chpath channel. But I noticed that this function was not easy to use because we couldn't call it sequentially if we wanted to do so. So I changed the function to always run sequentially. In the compile function, there are no Go routines, and reading, compiling, and writing processing are executed sequentially. By doing this, users can choose to call this function sequentially or concurrently. Users can call this function sequentially by just calling it, and users can call this function concurrently by simply adding a Go keyword before the execution of the function. Like this, by making a function run sequentially, we can give users the option to call it sequentially or concurrently. And that made the package simple and easy to extend, easy to use. Using an interface as a function parameter is another way to give users freedom in using our package. The placeAndCompile function gets a file path as a parameter and loads the file specified by the parameter. It's not easy to use because, and we cannot load binary data from memory instead of a file on disk because all it can get is a file path. So I changed the function parameter from the file path string to an IO reader interface so that users could pass to the compile function any data they wanted to load and compile. By having done this, this compile function became much more flexible because it could accept any kind of data as a parameter. The same thing applies to the output processing. This compile function wrote the result data only to a file on disk. Users could not write the result data to other locations. To solve this issue, I added an IO writer interface parameter to the compile function so that users could write the result data to anywhere they liked. As a result, this compile function read data from the IO, compiled the data, and wrote the result to the IO writer. By having done this, users could write the result data to anywhere they wanted by passing to the compile function an IO writer, which wrote data to the specified location. As this example shows, we can make our functions much more flexible and useful to users by using an interface as a function parameter. Finally, I'd like to talk about testing. Testing is necessary to maintain and enhance Go packages effectively and continuously. Above all, aiming to accomplish 100% of the test coverage is important. There are three main advantages to do so. Firstly, we can detect the regression when we modify our package. Secondly, we can keep up with the updated versions of Go and the packages which our package depends on. Lastly, we can detect the rest condition in our package. Go's test command has the rest option, which detects rest condition. And we can easily check if there is a rest condition in a package. Replacing a global variable's value with another value is helpful in accomplishing 100% of the test coverage. Here is example code. We cannot test the functional block, which calls the OS exit function, because this function terminates the testing process. We can test this code by using a global variable. First, we define a global variable which has value of the OS exit function, and call this function in the main call this global variable in the main function. In the upper example code, the exit global variable is defined and has value of the OS exit function, and it's called in the main function. After that, in the testing code, we assign another function which does nothing to the global variable. In the lower example code, a function which does nothing is assigned to the exit global variable before the testing. By doing this, we can test the whole main function. Table-driven tests are useful when we have to test many cases. Here is the example code. First, we define a slice of the test cases. Each case has the input data and the expected result data. And in the testing code, we can test each case by looping the slice of the test cases. This method makes our testing code simple, readable, and very maintainable. There are many CI services which can test Go code. Here is a list of CI services. Appia is useful because it can test Go code in a Windows environment. The other services do so in a Linux environment. And there are test coverage reporting services such as CoverAuth and CodeCov. I usually use Appia Worker and CoverAuth. That's all for my presentation. I hope you found the tips helpful and will consider using them in the future. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. Thank you very much.